Go with me to the book of 1 Timothy, chapter number 6. I love the Lord. I love His word. All of our musicians weren't able to come on today, but I appreciate the choir. They did an awesome job. Sister Kristen, they backed me on it every day just like me, and I appreciate them. They must love Jesus.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, I'm just like, y'all can get some meat because she's over there. God bless you. 1 Timothy chapter number 6. I wonder if we could read in concert verses 11 through 14. God is good. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
But thou, O man of God, flee these things.
Mm-hmm.
Fall after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight a good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called. And has professed a good profession before many witnesses. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I ask, O God, that you will speak to our hearts and to our minds, that you will challenge us as only you can challenge. Thank you, God, for this appreciation service for this man's servant. Thank you, God, for the years that you have blessed him to be here. Thank you for the vision. Thank you for the people of God. I pray, Father, somehow, some way, that you release a prophetic anointing in this house will cause teaching and preaching to become easy. Lord, challenge us in the ways that you would have us, O God, to glory. Now, God, you be glorified. The devil be horrified, and the people of God remain sanctified. In Jesus' name, if you love that name, say amen. Hallelujah to the Lord. God bless you. Yeah, I think it's 15 years. 15 years. God bless you. And we're here to celebrate these 15 years. I want to talk to you from just two words today. Better man. Better man. Look at somebody, better man. Man does not necessarily have any gender, but just look at somebody and tell them, I'm a better man. Had to go through some stuff, but I'm a better man. Had to climb some mountains, went through some valleys, but I tell you, I'm a better man because of what we went through. Paul's life, as we look at 1 Timothy, was filled with adversity. He was constantly misunderstood by his fellow believers. He was relentlessly harassed by the enemies of the gospel. Scripture teaches us that he spent many days, many weeks, many months, and even years in jail cells simply because of his faith in Jesus Christ. If you ever think God cannot use us in mighty ways because of the adversities that we have encountered, think again. If you ever get discouraged because of what seems to be like strikes against you, think again. Remember, my brothers and sisters, that Paul did not become a Christian until he was more than 30 years old. The majority of people today, my brothers and sisters, come to Jesus Christ before the age of 15. Paul did not start his formal ministry until he was 40 years old. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Paul did not shun hardship. Paul didn't shun persecution. The Bible teaches us his missionary travels of thousands of miles was mostly on foot or in crude sailing vessels. He endured frequent floggings, exposure to death, multiple imprisonments, 5 times receiving 39 lashes, beatings, and stonings. And by the time most Christians reach the age of 40, they can't walk 2 miles. They're already looking forward to retirement, and they will define hardship as waiting 30 minutes to be seated at their favorite restaurant. Paul said it made him a better man. Pray for him.
All right, all right.
Note the text on the day, my brothers and sisters. The subject of these verses is the man of God. The man of God. It appears in verse number 11 as a title the Apostle Paul gives to Timothy. A title, my brothers and sisters, that is simple yet immeasurably wonderful and rich. What a privilege it is to be called a man of God, or even God's man. It is a possessive phrase indicating that Timothy belonged to God in a special and unique way. You ought to just lay hands on yourself and say, he's talking about me. Yeah, help you, Holy Ghost. Only one person, my Bible, in the New Testament is ever called man of God, and it is Timothy, and it is in this particular text. We first find that Moses was called a man of God in the Old Testament, and in the New Testament we find that Timothy has been called a man of God. In a special and unique way, Timothy was God's man. And Paul now uses his title, brothers and sisters, to increase the sense of responsibility that Timothy had to discharge his ministry that God had called him to. To be reminded you are God's man, to be reminded that you are the very possession of God, is to be reminded of great responsibility. I promise you, my brothers and sisters, because now we take ministry too lightly. We feel like that all you got to do is get up and say anything to the people and to go on, oh, the devil is a liar.
Amen.
Remind ourselves that we must stand and give an account to God for every soul that is under our leadership. But not only this, what a joy it is that God would see something within us to call us to speak his word. Somebody say, yes, Lord. But at the same time, understand that great responsibility comes with great discipline. You see, discipline allows a man to act favorably in unforeseen circumstances. Discipline, brothers and sisters, creates an order, strategic way of living. Discipline allows you to respond rather than to react to unexpected situations. May I remind you, the enemy comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus says, I am come that you might have light and that you may have it more abundantly. The devil is upset because you have disowned him, that you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. So the last thing he wants you to do is to have an intimate relationship with God, and then what he ever think he would do is that he would use the circumstances of life to cause all of us to go back acting like the fools that we once were. Somebody say amen. I know I'm not in that boat all by myself. Amen. When I was a sinner, I was a good sinner. Amen. I did everything that the devil told me to do. I did it with boldness. I was a fool for the devil, but I'm a real fool for Jesus Christ. Somebody shout hallelujah to God. You see, we learn, my brothers and sisters, to see intrusions now as divine opportunity to watch God show up and show out.
Yes,
Psalms 27:14, the psalmist reminds us, wait upon the Lord, and he will renew thy strength. Yes, again, I say, wait upon the Lord. Isaiah the prophet teaches us, amen, that God declared, amen, he knows our thoughts from afar off, and he knows the very meditations of our heart. Yes. A miracle then, my brothers and sisters, can be understood now as a divine opportunity. And we often miss the miracle because we don't like the intrusion in our normalcy. We want everything to go just the way we plan. We got to understand that some things are ordered by God. Everything that comes up against you is not from the devil. Some things God put us through just to make us better. Somebody say that. I'm a better man this afternoon, my brothers and sisters, because of the intrusions of life that the God of life brought me out of. I learned in Psalms 23 that David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. It's not that I like the valley. He didn't tell me to stay in the valley. He didn't tell me to make the valley my place of habitation. But David said, as I walk through the valley, in other words, my destiny is not to remain in the valley, but my destiny is to get that mountaintop experience with God. But you can't appreciate the mountaintop except that you've been down in the valley. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Somebody shout hallelujah. So I rejoice how God brought me out. Would you just look at somebody and say, he brought me out. That's why Paul teaches us in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for the good unto them that love the Lord, to them who are called according to his purpose in Christ Jesus. Note the text again, my brothers and sisters, but thou, O man of God, but thou, my brothers and sisters, is set in contrast to the false teacher. You see, the false teachers are into everything mentioned from verses 3 all the way to verse number 10. But you, he says, in contrast, he said, you're different. He said, you are man of God. Would you look at somebody and say, don't roll your eyes at me, I can't help but I'm different. Paul told me that we are a royal priest. priesthood. Paul said that we are a peculiar people. Paul said that we are a holy nation. And so God has called us not to be like the world, but to be separate from the world. Somebody say yes, Lord. So some of the things that the world cry about, I learned how to rejoice it. I learned how to count those things, as James said. Count it all joy. Look at somebody say, count it all joy. Mind you, my brothers and sisters, to never be consumed with who they are, because so many times we get wrapped up in who they are. It's not about they are, it's about who you are. So don't worry about man's money, don't worry about the sin man, don't worry about the hell man, but recognize that you are God's man, that you are God's woman. You've been washed in his blood, you've been redeemed through the blood of Jesus Christ, you've been sanctified by the Holy Spirit of God. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. When we look at the word O in a particular text is a personal appeal. It's an emotional appeal. I worship your God. He said, but you, O man of God, remember now, my brothers and sisters, your spiritual beginnings, and whatever you do, don't you lose your identity. You see, as a man of God, brothers and sisters, you are to have the characteristics that can be seen and the characteristics can be measured. Anybody can talk a good talk. Anybody can give you a little testimony. Anybody can throw your hands up and say, let's worship and praise God. But I found out that when I was in the world, sometimes we say, stop your talking and let's get to throw it. You have to stop the talking and get to walk. Somebody is watching your walk with God. Somebody shout hallelujah to God. Let me hurry up here. There are four marks, my brothers and sisters, of a man of God. Four marks. Number one, a man of God is marked by what he flees from. Number two, a man of God is marked by what he follows after. Number three, a man of God is marked by what he fights for. And number four, a man of God is marked by what he is faithful to. A man of God is known by what he flees from. That's a present imperative, my brothers and sisters. Keep on continuing. Flee it. The word of God said, flee from youthfulness. You may have to be like Joseph. You have to leave your coat. Leave your coat, but keep your integrity and keep your anointing. Somebody shout hallelujah. I find that a good run is better than a hard fall. Y'all won't hear me today. Flee the love of money and all of its attendant grief. Flee lust. Flee temptation. Flee hurtful things. Flee errors in faith. Flee sorrows. Flee griefs. Flee these particular things is what Paul is speaking to us, because a man of God is known by what he flees from. He flees from having other gods in his heart. Deuteronomy 6:4 is called Sheba. Hear, O Lord, the Lord thy God is one Lord, and I shall love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy strength. Number two, the man of God is also known by what he follows after. Now, notice now, because in verse number 11, it gives us six virtues. These virtues are righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and meekness. This is all right today. Somebody say, let it happen. And so the man of God, yes, Lord, by continually running from, is also running to. Something behind him he wants to avoid. Something ahead of him that he wants to catch. You see, life in Christ, my brothers and sisters, is not just running from what's wrong. It's running towards what's right. Our whole life, my brothers and sisters, is in a pursuit of what is right and fleeing from what is wrong. A man of God, my brothers and sisters, is known by what he runs from, but he's also known by what he runs after. Forget those things which are behind and look forward to those things which are before. Paul said, I press towards the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Look at these on this evening. The first two are overarching virtues, one having to do with external behavior, the other has to do with internal attitude and motive. Help me to preach here, Holy Ghost. Number three, my brothers and sisters, the man of God is known by what he fights for. Help me, Holy Ghost. Again, my brothers and sisters, it is present imperative. God says, keep on fighting and be always battling. Race is not given to the swift nor to the strong, but unto him that shall endure unto the very end. The term, my brothers and sisters, is used in military context as well as in athletic context. It describes now the concentration and the great effort coupled with discipline and conviction that is required to win. Look at somebody say, don't give no place to the devil. Come on, say it again, don't give no place to the devil. just the word place, amen. The Greek word gives us English word, topography. In other words, God says, don't give the devil nothing to be able to work with. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse number 7. Paul said, I have fought a good fight. Paul said it was a battle, it was a warfare, and to perceive it as anything less is simply means to lose. Understand today, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to hurry up here. We battle the world, we battle the flesh, we battle the devil, we battle sin, we battle sin, we battle heresy. And Paul looked and said, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? He looked down to life. He said, I thank God it's through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Look at somebody say, I've been through some stuff, but I'm a better man. So therefore, my brothers and sisters, I worship. We're ready to close this thing and go home. So the man of God, dear brothers and sisters, is known by what he flees from, what he follows after, what he fights for, and lastly, what he's faithful to. To sum it up this evening, my brothers and sisters, it is faithful to complete the word of God. David said, like if thy word, O Lord, have I hid within my heart, that I may not sin against you. The last thing I want to do is to break the heart of God. Somebody here knows something about the goodness of God. And I've been for the goodness of God and the mercy of God, none of us would be here on today. But because of God's goodness and because of God's mercy, all of us got a testimony as to how good God has been. Somebody shout hallelujah to him. So Paul reminds us this thing is not just by speaking it, but look at somebody say, you got to live this thing. You got to walk it out. You just can't talk it. You got to walk this thing out. You see, what good does it do, my brothers and sisters, to speak the truth and then turn around and live a lie? Paul says in Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 13, Paul said, brother, I count not myself to have apprehended. He said, but there's one thing I do. Look at somebody say, just keep the one thing. Right. Keep on pressing. Keep reaching forward to those things from before. Forget about the haters. Forget about the backbiters. Forget about the liars.
Go ahead, Phil.
Somebody said, I got to see Jesus. I got to see the one who hung up on Calvary's cross for me. I got to see the one that saved me, that redeemed me. Don't worry about the haters. Those are the ones that try to kick you to the curb. Those were the ones that said they would never amount to anything. I come to tell you, I got a testimony. He looked beyond my fault and he saw my need. I want you to look at somebody and say, I'm sure enough saved. Did nobody have to tell me I was saved? When God saved me, I knew that I was saved. Somebody shout hallelujah to God. Can I keep it on 100 today? I come to tell you, I've been through some stuff. Still going through some stuff. Been through hell and high water. I come to tell you, I'm a better man. And that's what I want to come to encourage my brother on his anniversary today. We've been made two or four night, but sure, it's coming in the morning. Look at somebody say, I'm better. It was bitter, but I'm better. It hurt, but I'm better. I was broken, but I'm better because of what I went through. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. I'm going to remind you, my brothers and sisters, you cannot last staying in your past. And the last thing you want to do is get stuck on stupid. The devil is a liar. Look at somebody say, you're better than that. And that's why the psalmist said, lift up your heads, all you gifts. And then you lifted up your everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty in battle. He brought me out of a horrible pit. Somebody clap your hands and give God some praise. And shout hallelujah to the Lord. Somebody said, don't be ashamed of his name. Yeah, Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed to confess you before my Father. You go to a text in the Bible, said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. I come to tell you, God's love today includes your deliverance. Whatever you were tied up, tangled up in, your deliverance came because of the love of God. You just the way you are. He didn't wait till you become a better man. He didn't wait till you start acting right. He saved you right where you was at. He got right down in the midst of the murk and the mire. It was Jesus that picked you up and turned you around. It was Jesus that washed you with his blood. It was Jesus that filled you with the power of the Holy Ghost. It's the wonderful name of Jesus. Aren't you glad this evening? He didn't leave you rock, and he saw my knees. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Lord, say Jesus, sing a song to amazing grace. How sweet the sound to save the wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I found I was blind, but now I see. What I love about God's grace is, this grace does not reject you for what you have done. There is hope, my brothers and sisters. Even if you smell like dope, there is hope. Because Isaiah 53:5, he was wounded for my transgressions. He was bruised for my iniquities. And the chastisement of my peace was upon him. A good God Almighty, by his stripes I am healed. Matthew 1 and 21 declares, you shall bring forth a son, and I shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Anybody in here ever hear the call upon the name of Jesus? Somebody shout hallelujah. Regardless of the problems of life, you and I have the answer. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the hope of the world. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the Savior of mankind. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the one who lifts every burden. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the way. We got the truth. We got the life. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the Alpha. We got the Omega. We got the beginning and the end. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the Word of Life. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the Bread of Heaven. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the One who was, who is, and who is to come. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the Savior who died for our sins of the world. His name is Jesus Christ. We got the Victor over the devil. We got the Victor over the grave. And his name is Jesus Christ. And the reason I can look at the pastor and say you're a better man, because there's a risen king that lives down inside of you. I got the King of Kings down inside of me. His name is Jesus Christ. I find somebody and ask him, do you know anything about the name of Jesus? If he can get you out of every death situation,